Welcome to Heart to Hearties. We are very excited today to join you in anticipation of season 11. And I am Marg Stark from very sunny Southern California. And I'm joined today by...
Hi, I'm Amy from Massachusetts.
And I'm Dawn from North Carolina.
And Johannah from BC.
We're thrilled to have you, Johannah. So we will welcome Mamie Laverock to our chat in just a little bit. But Joe, catch us up. Tell us what has been the highlight of your hiatus so far. We know you wrapped last fall, right before Christmas. So what's been going on?
We went straight into a big old family Christmas. This was sort of the first year kind of since COVID, you know, that everybody was kind of all comfortable to be all together, you know, because, you know, have some elderly folks and some health issues in our family. So this was the first time when, you know, we were the ones to host the 24 person dinner, et cetera, et cetera. So spent several weeks preparing for that, several weeks recovering from that.
Indeed. Okay.
We need a vacation from your vacation, right?
That's right.
I'm joking. It was a joy to be together, but I'm not going to lie. It was, you know, it's a lot of work hosting and preparing three meals a day for lots of people. But it was great to be all together. It's not the most interesting thing that I'm doing, but it is definitely the most time consuming, which is very fortunate to be able to be building a small home on one of the Gulf Islands. So that's been taking all of my time and energy. So yeah, that's what I'm doing. Yeah.
Yeah. You said in one of your emails that you were on a ferry and not great Wi-Fi.
Yes.
And all that kind of stuff.
And you can imagine getting supplies on a, you know, in your car and on the boat. And it's a whole thing. And I should add, one of the joys of right after Christmas, I started the new year with a really nice acting job on a Hallmark movie of the week, where I did a really fun role in a film that Aaron Krakow is the lead in. It was really fun.
Awesome.
It was the first time, I mean, I can't believe it's taken 11 years, but it was the first time that we've been on a film set together, not When Calls the Heart, playing different characters. So that was actually so much fun, just because, you know, I mean, Aaron and I, you know, have a great time on When Calls the Heart, but, you know, often our scenes together are brief, you know, there's so many characters and 45 minutes of airtime, and, you know, there's just never enough time for all the things that they would love to do with all the characters. So, you know, even though, you know, Aaron and I are often on screen together, you know, we don't have lengthy scenes, you know, one-on-one. And so it was really fun that we had a couple scenes where it was just us for quite a lengthy scene. And and just being able to play different characters, you know, and not be on the set of When Calls the Heart. It was just so fun to shake it up. My character is really different from Molly. So that's always fun for people to see me play.
Oh,
and, you
know, awesome. Yeah. Awesome. Okay. Well, Hearties have so much to look forward to in the next month. It's, you know, with Viv and Natasha and Rothgar, the fall
right?
And in their movie. So it's just, spring is going to be... it's going to be blooming. It's going to be amazing.
Agreed. Yeah. You know, and I think Hallmark should get the message that I think that's for, they should pair us together more often, because I think it's
so fun.
The fans.
So much fun. Yeah. So much fun. Yeah. So on top of the Rosaleen storyline, which is kind of mind blowing in and of itself,
right?
Not even kind of, it's very mind blowing. We just had so many favorite Molly moments in season 10, whether it was you all conspiring to surprise Rosemary for her shower, the frenzied running about scene when Rosemary went into labor in Main Street, the barbecue sauce tasting, loved that, the choir scenes. I mean, we could go on and on, but what were your favorites in season 10 and why?
Yeah, well, you nailed some of the my favorite ones. I mean, the comedic relief that our characters sort of play is always really fun. That was the birth scene, the going into labor scene, was particularly fun because it's not often that all of the cast gets to be part of a comedic bit, you know, because there's just so many characters. And Peter DeLuise, to his credit, you know, was the maestro, you know, coordinating that symphony. And he looked great on the page. Like, don't get me wrong, it was already a cute scene, but he really, in his inimitable way, was like, okay, I want you to do this, and this is the funny bit, and make sure, like, it was, you know, okay. So you can imagine shooting that. I mean, it's obviously some editing, but there was a lot of kind of trying to get a lot in one shot, right? Like with all the chaos and the kind of everybody panicking. So yeah, that was really, really, it was actually, so fun to shoot that because, as I say, we were all on set, you know, for a good chunk of that day working on making that scene as cute and as funny and as alive as possible. So that was really fun. I mean, often we do those big crowd scenes in the you know, the saloon or whatever, but it was just a different flavor than the comedy of that one, as you can imagine, right? So that was super fun. Always a joy to be with Flomo and, you know, with our fun little barbecue tasting. That was super cute to do. fun, right? And obviously the highlight for me of season 10 was being reunited with Rosaleen. So
well, truly incredible. And I just watched that scene again, the birth scene again last week, and every time I watch it, I see something new and funny. Right? And it's just, you know, I think the first time I was distracted by knowing that Andrea was pregnant and carrying that big bag.
Right?
And was running.
Poor Andrea, what a trooper.
You know, it just was, and Flo, of course, with her hilarious.
Her running.
The way she runs.
That was
Yeah.
That was
but it really was. It was all of you. As you said in that comedic moment, it was really fun. It was
glad.
Yeah. Worth a rewatch, Hearties. Go
excellent.
Back.
Excellent. Delighted to hear it.
So talking about Hearties are very detail oriented, as I'm sure you've noticed. They like to know every little detail about their favorite characters.
Yes.
And one thing they're really curious is about the past that we haven't seen when season one started. So if you were to write the story about how Molly ended up in Coal Valley, what would that look like?
Well, you know, the show went through, you know, some sort of tone shifts early on, as you know, and they asked me to do it, to just do a whisper of an Irish accent for that first season. A tiny whisper. And that was sort of massaged away. I mean, you know, and perhaps, you know, with a year or two being in Coal Valley, it would have sort of, you know, gone away anyway. But I mean, the initial character breakdown was that she was Irish. And so for me, I just assumed that, you know, she had grown up in Ireland and gone on a boat and come over. And it's actually, I think, one of the reasons that I chose to go that way with it. I mean, she's obviously been in North America for a while, and you know, we never met Patrick, and so Patrick is an Irish name, and so in my mind we were both Irish, and so I feel like we came over from Ireland together, and that's a sort of a story close to my heart. I mean, it's not specifically Ireland, but I did 23andMe, and I'm like 99.9% Irish, Scottish, English. Ooh, no surprise. So, and my great grandmother, Jessie Kennedy, came over when she was 19 on that boat from Liverpool, from the north of England. And so, and I had the great honor of knowing my great grandmother. She lived to 103. She had 13 children and was sharp as a tack right till the very end.
Love that.
So she was quite a woman. And so you can imagine, I mean, it just breaks my heart. The idea back in those days, you know, you weren't jumping back, you weren't hopping on a plane and going to see your relatives in Liverpool, you know, so you knew at 19, you were saying goodbye to you hugged your mother on the dock and waved off. And there was a very high probability that you wouldn't see each other again. Mm-hmm. So like, as a mother myself, I can't even think about that. So heartbreaking. And so she came over at 19 and started her life in Canada, you know, so that would have been, gosh, it would have been actually right around the time of When Calls the Heart, because she, you know, she passed away in around, you know, 2000. My daughter was 2. So we had 5 generations alive at one point.
Wow.
So that's pretty special. So I'm just telling you this because for me, that's how I sort of conceived of Molly's backstory. And, you know, it's, as you know, where exactly Coal Valley, Hope Valley is located is sort of never really discussed. So, I mean, which is great because it kind of leaves it open for anybody's sort of interpretation of, I mean, you know, Mountie, a border town, you know, between the States and Canada. Mounties are obviously Canadian. So, but I sort of envision it sort of being either sort of, you know, Colorado, Washington. I mean, is that same for you ladies? Is that kind of how you, where you conceive of it, the mythical town being? Yeah. So, you know, we would have landed on the East Coast, Molly and Patrick, and and, you know, and wound our way to the promised land of the West, you know, so.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Too cool.
Yeah.
I'm loving it. I think I see a spinoff happening right here.
Right?
We're starting it right now. Right.
Thank
here.
You. You get writing. You get writing that, please. Thank you.
And then when we talk about Flo, when we talk about Molly, we can't talk about her without talking about Flo too. So Absolutely. Kind of along that same lines, talking about backstories, how do you think Flo and Mo bonded together and became the friends that we see them as today?
Great question. Now, obviously, think they were close to begin with, but I do think they bonded particularly over the very tragic death of their husbands.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I mean, I think that we were definitely friends. But you know how it is when you're, I was, you know, you're busy with your children, you're busy with your husband. And, you know, like in that day and age, you're busy hand washing your clothes. Like I remember talking to my great grandmother and my grandmother, washing day would take all day, like with 13 children, like literally there was washing day. So, mm-hmm. you know, even though I'm sure we had times to, you know, grab a tea at the cafe or something. I mean, you know, I think turn of the century or early 20th century, that was, we're everybody's busy, oh, yeah. you know, so. I do think that perhaps when the tragedy of the mine disaster happened, that I think we purposely started spending more time together just because we mm-hmm. all needed the support and the love and friendship and community of that. So I do think we were close, but I think we got extra close when husbands mm-hmm. passed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, makes sense.
So
now to get to specific Hearties and their questions, we have a question from Laurel Wetzel of Atlanta, Georgia. Nice. And she is wondering, does Molly live off the settlement from the trial judge in season 2, or do you have a job that's been paying your bills all this time?
Well, this is an excellent question. And I think at some Hearties reunion, I said, you know, that settlement money ran out a while ago. Molly needs a job, right? And that was one of the seasons before she, you know, she sort of dabbled a bit here and there. But you know, one of the fun storylines, I'm embarrassed. Please forgive me. Some of the seasons all blend together in my aging brain. But the season when she started working at the doctor's office, Dr. Carson, you know, and that fun little setup they had with that, me all being a overly keen and a bit of a hypochondriac.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, I think that was the first time that you really saw her get a, you know, consistently paying job, and that sort of carried on, you know, now that she's working with Dr. Carter. Yeah. And you know, who knows what's going to happen next.
That's great.
Yeah.
So Molly is not, she's an evolved woman. She yep. doesn't need a man. So
independent. So that's sweet, right.
But you know, we have a question from Sheila Burton of Morehouse, Missouri. And she wants to know if the ship has sailed on a romance with Bill Avery.
Okay, so honest, hand on my heart, I honestly don't know. So here's the problem. Between seasons, I think it's probably quite surprising to the Hearties that we literally, we don't know, that the writers are off in their writer's room, the showrunner is the maestro of that whole world. And very often, I mean, we may have a little, sometimes I might reach out and be like, what do you think of this storyline? Or sometimes. Some input, but often they're just off being creative and coming up with what they come up with. So as you could see in season 10, there was a little bit of that sort of wasn't an emphasis, but I'm not just saying this to jerk anybody's chain. I honestly don't know. I mean, I think Molly and Bill they have a lot of respect, a lot of good vibes, you know, long-term friendship going on there. I mean, I could see it going either way. I could see them spending more time together as friends, deepening that relationship, or I could see, you know, the spark kind of rekindling again. I think they'd be a really fun pair. I think they're, you know, similar enough in some ways and opposite enough in some ways, just to keep it fun and interesting. Opposites yeah. attract, you know, and he needs a little bit of Molly's, you know, sass in his life. So Yeah, and you know, she's good at teasing him for being a, you know, a loving, a sweet curmudgeon. So, I mean, I honestly, I wish I could say more about that. I think there's still possibilities there. Whether or not they're gonna choose that storyline, I honestly could not tell you. I think it would be really fun, and I think there'd be a lot of Hearties that would be down for that one. Sure. But I just don't know.
Well, I love the when Molly was teaching Bill to drive.
Yes, that, cute, right?
That was just gold.
Right? Yeah. I mean, let's admit, you know, we've all had those moments in our relationships where you're like, okay, I'm gonna, no matter what the gender is, like, you know,
exactly.
Whether it's the husband or the wife or the wife or the husband, we all know those moments.
That's funny. No, I love that whole, those scenes, especially in that season. It was so good.
Right. Oh, thank you. That's so sweet.
So there's another one with Heather Hood of Minneapolis. And she loves the tenure that you have on the show. So with a decade of the show underneath your belt, what has proved the most fulfilling aspect professionally and why?
Okay, well, I think it'll come as no surprise to you to say that the thing I cherish the most from my 10 years to get 10, the 10 years of making this show is twofold. Well, threefold. First off, just that we have such a wonderful group of humans that have been the main cast for so long, you know, and, you know, obviously Hollywood loves to gossip, and sometimes I think they make stories up about people not getting along who actually do. But in our case, we actually all get along so well. We have such a lovely time together. It's just been such a joy to spend 10 years of your life is a really big chunk of your life. For many of us, it's a quarter of our life. For some of the younger people, it's a half of their life. You know, 10 years is a significant amount of time. And to get to just go, you know, grow and experience 10 years of life and all the things that we've all personally been through, you know, marriages and babies, you know, children going off to university in my case, you know, global drama, pandemics, all that. So we've gone through all of that together, and it's just, you know, it's just deepened all of our relationships and our friendships, and it's just so precious and so wonderful. And often many of the directors have been along for the ride, so just all of it. And then we have some crew. I mean, some of the crew has come and gone as they've needed to do, but we've had some crew that have been there for many, many years. So it's just really special. It really does have a family vibe. And it's just every time I'm always ecstatic when we get renewed for another season professionally, but I'm also ecstatic personally. And then also, you know, having a chance to connect with the Hearties. I mean, it's such a special and unique fan base, as you all are very well aware. I mean, what actor ever gets a 10-year job? I mean, you can honestly count, I think, I don't know, the statistical number of actors that ever get beyond a 5-year job, let alone a 10-year job. I mean, we're now heading into Grey's Anatomy and, you know, Friends territory. Like, it's very, very rare and very, very precious. So professionally, that's amazing. But then also to go along with the fan base for 10 years. I mean, how many actors get to spend 10 years with certain, like, some of the fans have been with us since the very beginning. How many actors get to spend 10 years with certain fan bases? None. Like, it's truly exceptional. And yeah, just the you know, I mean, obviously Hearties are passionate and they've got strong feelings about things, which is totally understandable. I mean, it's one of the reasons they're invested. It's one of the reasons we love them, because they care about the show. So obviously there's, you know, it's been some bumps along the road, but here we are, we're still together and we're all still rooting for these characters. And I just, I've been so touched by, in so many ways, by the love and care and support of the Hearties. It's been deeply meaningful for me. Yeah. So
that's lovely. And the thing, well, the crew, it's so interesting when we talk to the crew, people that are, they just discovered or get the job like in season 5 or season 6, and they're like, I needed to know that 5 years ago. I was going to be there for the whole time. But right. They love the atmosphere of the set. So I think that's a, you know, like a compliment to everyone.
Exactly.
The directors and, you know, the set people and, you know, and the actors, things like that. So
yeah, the culture, the environment is exactly, a place that people want to be, because, you know, as some of you I'm sure are very well aware, film sets are hard at the best of times, let alone at the worst of times. So the best of times is, you know, people treating each other well, you know, just a good family environment. It's hard enough even in that environment. So do you know what I mean? So I think if when people show up, because it's a tough job no matter what, that they're like, oh, it's a tough job, but these are great people. It just makes it all doable, you know? So sure. Exactly. Yeah.
We have our next guest. So we are going to transition to her and then awesome. We'll go back.
So we want to welcome to the conversation now, Mamie Laverock. She plays Rosaleen in season 10 and reprising her role from season 1. Wow. So imagine, you can't imagine, Mamie, how much joy it brought to the Hearties to have you return.
Truly.
Really.
Thank you, guys.
It really was.
They had been asking about you for the entire 10 years, and I just kept praying one day that it would come to pass, and when it did, I was just ecstatic. So.
Yeah, it's
thank you.
And I know the writers, you know, they work so hard on this show to provide continuity, which is not an easy thing to do over such a long period of time, where in, you know, one of the busiest hubs in the world for actors, and, you know, having to work with schedules and, you know, not knowing if you're going to be renewed and everything else. So I love it that they had such a heart for bringing you back too. It really speaks right. to them too. But truly, if we ran a poll, I am certain that a telling silence from season 1 would rank among the top 5 favorite Hearties episodes. It's everyone always mentions what a beautiful and meaningful and truly just heart-filled show it was. So Caroline Richardson of South Carolina wonders how you two feel about having that show have such a lasting impact. Mamie, do you want to start?
Sure. Having the season one episode.
Yes.
Yes. That 10 years later, we're still talking about it.
It's pretty crazy. Like, I don't think any of this stuff kind of like comprehends fully in my mind. It's just kind of like, I'm just kind of here and I'm like, that's so great, you know, to the past Mamie, you know?
I mean, yeah, as I said, like, this is, Mamie was 8. You were 8 when we shot that?
Yeah.
I was like, 8. Yeah. So like the, cause she's so young, she was so young for some of those intervening years. I would tell her mom, you know, like, but I think as a child, it's maybe hard to digest. I cannot tell you, Mamie, like twice a month, however often, very, very often throughout this whole 10 years, people mention that episode. They mention our relationship and you know, your beautiful performance, which was Leo nominated, very, very rightly so. So heartbreaking, so beautiful. I mean, and I'm always amazed by any wonderful acting, but especially wonderful acting done by a child is always particularly amazing to me. And people, so many people keep saying, I've watched that episode 20 times and every time I cry like a baby, it just gets me in the feels every time. It's really one of those episodes, Mamie, that really speaks to people. And so I think I've done a pretty good job of telling your mom that, but I'm telling you here in front of everybody now, it has been consistent, as Mark said, you know, for a show that's done over 100 episodes now, that for that episode to be one of people's top, basically, as she says, top 5 episodes is pretty, pretty fantastic. And that was very much in no small part your performance, Mamie. So
it must have been hard. I mean, I guess on the one hand, as an 8-year-old, not having a lot of dialogue because you were mute, you know, makes things a little bit easier, but then acting in the way that you did without dialogue is hard. It's extraordinary. Yes. I don't know if you can remember any of that. Wow. At 8.
Yeah, I definitely, throughout the filming, I do remember it. When you don't use your voice, you definitely have to dive deep into how you feel. And it makes it a little bit more challenging because people are not only reading the energy behind your words, but then just reading the energy as it is, which is pretty cool. It's definitely something that I hadn't looked at, like, in the way that I'm looking at it now. So at the time, I was kind of like, oh yeah, like, you know, I didn't really have much thought about it. But then looking at it now, I'm like, oh my gosh, that's so cool. Because, you know, in our everyday lives now, like, that's something that we can bring out into the world, that, like, the energy behind the words is almost is more important than just the word that you're saying.
Yes. What's not being said is as powerful, if not more powerful, than what's being said. Absolutely.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, yeah, absolutely, Mamie. Such a good point. Wow.
That's very beautiful.
And as she says, like, how interesting to look back as adult Mamie, at that, or young, you know, young adult Mamie, to that 8-year-old performance and go and see things from adult Mamie and go, oh wow, like, some good stuff there, you know?
Yeah.
And yet there's that wonderful, you know, in, you know, with a child who's, you know, a healthy, happy child who's lived in a lovely, supportive home like yours, who has that ability to just be so natural and emotionally available at 8, you know? There's a lot of adults who aren't that emotionally available.
Yeah, my son went to school with somebody who had, I don't know what the condition is, is it selective?
Yeah, selective mutism, I think it's called.
Mutism, mm-hmm, and he has emerged, you know, later in his life. And there would be situations where he wasn't mute, at home with an extreme comfort, he would speak. But I can only imagine what that show must have meant to to families who were going through that. You know,
that's a lovely thing to add. I hadn't really conceived of it like that, but you're quite right, Mark.
I mean, because it, you know, would call a lot of attention to itself, obviously. And so it's just, you know, I don't think our love of that show, of that particular episode, will ever wane. It's just so beautiful.
Yay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. It means so much.
And now, Mamie, I have a question for you from Brian Shively from Lake Havasu City, Arizona. Hearties really love hearing what's happening behind the scenes. And his question is that he would really like to know the story behind your reaction when you found out that they were inviting you to come back to reprise your role again.
Well, in the moment, I feel like it was around a year and a half ago. So I'm 19 now. So it was, I think, just after I graduated high school. So there was a lot of things kind of like moving in the works. And then all of a sudden my mom comes up to me. She's like, "You have an audition for When Calls the Heart." I'm just like, "What?" Like, everything's just like so crazy. And then, like, yeah, it was amazing. It was hard to comprehend in the moment. I was just kind of moving through. Mm-hmm. And then we had the Zoom, a Zoom meeting where I had an audition. So we had an audition for the role. It was honestly just like, I was pretty removed from my feelings during that time. So I was like, wow, this is so amazing. But at the same time, I was kind of just like, I was kind of removed, like, from myself at that time.
Well, probably protecting yourself just in case it didn't work out too. Yeah, like,
exactly,
you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But just doing, like, being able to come back and see everyone again, it was just like, it was crazy, because literally no one has, like, physically changed. So I was just like, whoa, this is so weird. Like, I'm like so much older and everyone here, like, hasn't even changed a bit. And it's like, hello.
I slipped her $20 to say that.
That is very good. Yes. I think you're going to find your cast is very, very fond of you.
I mean, the children had changed very much, but.
Well, they just got a little taller. You know?
Just taller. Exactly. Just taller.
And Johannah, what was your reaction when they let you know that they were considering Mamie back.
I was beside myself with excitement. And I knew that the audition was, I mean, I don't want to call it a formality. I mean, they had to, it's a, you know, it was an important role. They hadn't seen Mamie in 10 years. You mm-hmm. know, they needed to know that she could do it. I mean, I knew she could do it, but you know, they needed to make sure. It's obviously a very important role. And so I was just so excited when, you know, I know that, you know, her family who, you know, some of them are actors themselves. And so they were coaching her and, you know, and I was like, do you need any help? Is there, like, I was just like a total, like a mom in the background being like, you can do it. This is amazing. So, yeah, I mean, I think I was as excited, if not more excited than Mamie, because yeah, for obvious reasons, it's just
like a big family reunion.
Literally. Yeah. And her, you know, Mamie's family is so lovely and dear to me. So it was just a big win for the whole family, not just for Mamie. Absolutely. It was just.
Yes. All right. And the next name I have to read, because it's a Hearty from the Netherlands.
Oh, wow.
Her name is Saskia van Lingen Elias.
Fabulous name.
Right?
Yeah.
So Mamie, she's wondering how you prepared for coming back into this role. Did you have to kind of go back and maybe watch the episodes again and kind of put your place at that younger age and then think through how you think that Rosaleen would have developed and become who she was when we watched her in this past season?
That's a good question. I feel like my character was very different in the first season because she was so young.
And traumatized.
I didn't really, I've never thought about that, but thinking about it now, I'm like, wow, that makes so much sense that I didn't look back and then keep moving forward, because I feel like that's kind of what Rosaleen would have done. She kind of left that in the past. She didn't look back, and she kind of just like created like a new version of herself, like moving forward. And then coming back, she's like getting bombarded with like all of these like memories and people. And it's just like, it's really overwhelming. But then she also gets the opportunity to like work through the stuff that she didn't get the opportunity to maybe even like really feel fully. So
yeah. Beautifully said. And also talk about art imitating life, because you, Mamie, were overwhelmed being back on the film.
Exactly.
Acting required. Yeah.
Exactly.
Hearties official Facebook group, we're at 90 something thousand members.
I think 96, 98.
Okay. All right. We're a lot of people.
Yes.
Voted. And the scene in which you made room for Henry in the pew during the choir performance was their favorite scene of the whole season. So artistically, though, we found the scene in the stable just like mind-blowingly perfectly executed in every respect. I mean,
agreed.
The directing, the acting, the script. I mean, it's just a stunning, stunning moment. Tell us what it was like for you to work with Martin, and what those scenes were like for you, Mamie.
Seeing it from kind of an outside perspective, I thought the storyline was very like beautifully placed in the with Gawain himself. It was just the first thing that comes to mind is it was really funny specifically in that scene, because in the stable, there's horses in the stable. And while we were like doing the scene, the horses were farting.
Those are the horses we need to see.
Right?
And did I already tell you, you ladies that I told the story about doing that when I said to come up to Bill and I'm like, you know, telling him that the uniform doesn't make the man, and I'm having to have this sort of, you know, semi-romantic heartfelt moment with Bill, and the horse is farting so loud in the middle of the scene. Honestly, Peter DeLuise was directing, and he tried to just, and then at one point the crew was like, you could, like, they were holding in the laughter so hard that he was like, cut, this, it's, anyway, thank Mamie, I know the feeling, carry on.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, so you're having this heartfelt scene and there's farting horses. Fantastic.
Exactly.
Well, that keeps things light. That's
exactly.
Yeah.
Airy. Wow. Airy, pun intended.
Airy.
Professional actors can deal with that.
Wow. Okay. And yeah. And but it's so it's a very intense scene. So that was breaking wind was breaking the mood. I'm sure. Yes. Wow.
It was definitely.
And did you talk to Martin before the scene, or you know, get any counseling from him, or you know, what was the relationship like between between you as scene partners?
We did get along during the filming. I was kind of like, I kind of like stayed to myself a little bit, because I was like meeting everyone for the first time again, kind of, because I was also a new version of myself. So it was like, yeah, I was meeting everyone else for the first time as well. So
were you kind of trying to stay in character then, not talking with them very much, or
yeah, pretty much, yeah. I guess
specifically with Gowan, right? Because Gowan is the one that you want to keep.
Yes,
I was pretty intimidated. I would say that's probably a good word to put.
Which plays into your character very well. So that works.
Exactly,
that works very well. Wow. Okay. And then my goodness, the mother-daughter scenes, the two of you together, the whole discussion about forgiveness. They were so touching. Tell us what those, and I'm going to say scenes, meant to you, because we know that Edify included on the season 10 DVD, one of the deleted scenes, which that was also incredibly beautiful. So tell us what those scenes meant to both of you. Maybe Johannah, you start.
Well, as you can imagine, you know, so having such a beautiful moment in season one and then having these beautiful moments 10 years later just felt like, you know, again, as an actor, such a gift, because how many actors get to do a scene with the same actor at 8 and the same and then 10 years? I mean, that's just unheard of, right? So it was just from an acting point of view, it was really amazing. From a personal view, a point of view, it was really amazing. And also who directed that episode was Elise Light Rogers. And that was the first season that she joined our wonderful family. And I just really loved the way the way that she directed. I really vibed with her. And I thought she handled our scenes really beautifully. So it was kind of just this perfect storm of circumstances where it was this really magical gift that it was Mamie, magical gift that it was, you know, these characters. And then this, you know, lovely female director. I mean, I love all our directors, but it was just, she brought her own unique, lovely touch to it. Yeah. And so there's like the meta view of it, and then there's every time I was with Mamie, I was in Johanna view, but I was also kind of pulled out from the Hearty view, and there was just, I just knew that this was going to mean such, it was going to mean so much to the Hearties, and so I was just excited on every possible level for it. So, you know, I just tried to stay in the scene rather than just being like fangirling over a storyline, kind of as a Hearty myself.
Love it, love it. And Mamie, what about, you know, how were those scenes for you that you got to share with Johannah?
They were beautiful. I feel like it's really funny because I feel like now there's so many like synchronicities like showing up in the past, and even just filming, like that is the past for me. And I'm like, at this moment, I'm learning like how to forgive myself fully so I can forgive others. And in that moment for me, I didn't realize like that specific scene would mean so much for me in my present moment.
Wow.
Oh, yeah, so goodness.
You are the perfect person to play this part. I mean, the levels here are kind of blowing my mind.
I know, that's why I was like, aside from the fact that she's literally the same person, how can it be anybody other than Mamie? She's perfect for this role.
No. The depth of intellect and sensitivity is quite remarkable. So we're going to turn to season 11. And I guess we presume that Rosaleen has now gone off to pursue her nursing school with the scholarship. No longer anonymously provided from Henry Gowan.
You got it.
So what excitement might be in store for Molly in this new season?
Season 11 is, there is more, there's a really fun storyline. Again, I'm never sure how much I can say, right? But right. One fun thing that carries through, which I think will be quite delightful, is, you know, we have this sort of this choir thing happening in season 10, which is so fun and so sweet. And was so much fun to shoot, as you can imagine. And that there's some lovely sort of choir stuff that continues on, which was, I think, for my character, was, I think, the highlight of season 11. I think there's not a lot else I can say without being annoyingly vague.
well, you'd be in very good company. With annoyingly vague.
Yeah, yeah. Annoyingly vague is annoying. But yeah, as you can imagine, I'm sure, buckle up. You all know it's going to be a wild ride. There is the ensemble, like the community vibe, you know, for some of the more secondary characters is sort of where they're the strongest in season 11, in the sort of support staff, like making some of the sort of more prominent storylines, you know, again, being the wonderful community contributors to, you know, a particular storyline or a particular romance. So that's, it was really fun to be, again, just all about community and coming together to, you know, in times of joy and in times of trouble. So yeah, so Molly and Florence got to play that role a lot in season 11, which is always delightful. So
we loved hearing that you did some assistant directing, and Marianne Klein of Jefferson City, Missouri wants to know, what was that experience like for you? And should we be on the lookout for that episode for any special touches that you feel like you brought to it?
Okay, well, you're incredibly kind to ask that question. Thank you. But I think it's a little bit confusing for people. So what I was doing was I was doing what's called shadowing, which basically means that I'm just Elise's shadow. I'm just peering over her shoulder, trying to learn as much as possible. I mean, she would very kindly be like, hey, Joe, like, what's your opinion about X, Y, or Z? But, you know, but the scene would sort of already be happening. So I can't say that I influenced anything. She was kind enough to let me just peer over her shoulder, and she was so generous with her time, you know, because of shooting, it's, you know, we shoot very, quite intensely, quite quickly. So, you know, any director has to show up incredibly ready to work hard, and there's barely any breaks. But she was very generous. Instead of going off and having a moment to herself, which I'm sure she desperately needed, she would very kindly, you know, open up her shot list and talk me through stuff or answer any questions I had. I think perhaps the only place I might have contributed anything is where she would ask me my opinion about an acting note, or because she knows I coach, and I coach children. So I think sometimes, you know, it's just, I mean, I think she was, not that she doesn't know how to deal with actors, but I think she was just trying to be inclusive and kind and, you know, ask me, you know, in a particular scene where she was dealing with a bunch of children, like, you know, was there any particular note that I might add for a particular performance or something? That's really all I can say that I might have contributed. But thank you so much for the question. I loved every minute of it. And I've always had immense respect for our crew, but, you know, working alongside them in that capacity behind the camera, because, you know, when you're acting, you're worried about your job, right? You're in front of the camera trying to make sure that's all working. And it was so fun to kind of just sit back and be behind the camera and watch everything from that point of view and just have a renewed depth of appreciation for the sheer physical effort that they expend and the incredible artistry that they all have in their various departments. As you all know, filmmaking is the ultimate team sport. And you know, I've always known that the people who ran the various departments on When Calls were incredibly talented, but you just get to really watch them do their own thing because you can focus on it as opposed to being worried about, you know, running back to hair and makeup or doing wardrobe changes. Like you don't leave set, you stay and you watch everything. And so it was just a really wonderful, it's not that I didn't know that already, but I just got to appreciate it with more detail. It was really, really special.
Which episode is it?
So it was block 6. So that would have been episode 5 and 6, I believe. So wait.
No, 6. That would be block.
Yeah, sorry, 6, oh. 6, 7, 6, sorry. Okay. Yeah, because okay. we do two blocks, yes. Two episodes per block.
Okay, yes. Oh,
yeah.
Okay, very cool. Love it.
Thank you. I loved it.
All right. So Mamie, Hearties they're going to be cheering you on. We love supporting our cast, both past and present. And Hearties are kind of going to be on the lookout for you. So we're wondering if you're continuing to perform or what's your life centered around right now?
But also you've been traveling. You've done some amazing traveling. Tell us more about that.
Yes. So I actually, very recently, I think about a month ago, I started from Vancouver to San Francisco, or no, from Vancouver to Seattle, then to San Francisco, and then from San Francisco to LA, and then from LA to, Nevada to see the is it Nevada or Colorado? Yep. Which has the
Nevada
Grand Canyon?
Yeah, the Grand Canyon.
Oh, Nevada. Yeah. And I saw the Grand Canyon and then went around through Idaho and there was one Salt Lake City we passed through.
Utah, yeah.
And, wow. Oh, and amazing. Utah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Traveling. Holy cow. Yeah.
Well, you've covered a lot of the states where we have a lot of Hearties too.
Yes.
And a lot of familiar locations from places that characters on When Calls the Heart have seemingly gone to. So
That's right.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Absolutely. And having been to the Grand Canyon myself, I mean, it's one of the great wonders of the world. So I'm sure that was quite magical for you.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
Like seeing photos, you're kind of like, oh, okay, mm-hmm. I kind of see what it's about, but then when you go there, it's like, oh my gosh, like it looks two dimensional.
It's a spiritual experience to watch the sunrise there. It really truly is. Yeah.
Wow. Seeing the sunrise there would be so pretty.
Magic. Yeah. Absolute magic. Yeah.
Wow.
And now Johannah, so one of your cast mates, Javen, loves to share the snacks that he's partaking in while he's live tweeting along with the Hearties.
Yes.
So we're kind of curious, if you had to pick a snack that kind of revealed the essence of season 11, the flavor, the texture, something about this new season. What?
I know I have the exact answer. So I think there's been moments planted throughout many years where either Frothgar or Loretta, their big mouths, has talked about my love of craft service and snacks. gotta keep your energy going somehow, whether it's little candy bags or bags of chips. I am definitely an enthusiastic snacker. I would have to say for season 11, my snack would be, and I don't know if they call it something similar in the US or different parts of the US. I think it's called different things. Does trail mix make sense? Does that do you? Okay.
Oh,
so they have these wonderful little bags of peanuts and raisins and like M&Ms. And so it's a season 11. It's a mixed bag of nuts. I think that sums it up because it's got the salty, it's got the sweet, mm-hmm. it's got the variety, the textures, the various textures and colors of season 11. Because, it's a real mix of romance and drama and humor. So it's a real mixed bag. So I thought trail mix. I mean, I do love trail mix. And that sums up season 11 for me quite nicely. So
it's so good.
You never know what's
going to be in each bag. That's right.
So Hearties, we're going to have to stock up on trail mix because season 11 is literally around the corner. But honestly, the beautiful scenes that you all created together in season 11, season 1 and season 10, they're going to stay with us for a very long time. So we're so grateful to both of you for your performances and for bringing us such enduring messages. Thank you for joining us.
What a lovely way to spend the afternoon. I've enjoyed this so much. It's been such a nice break from house building, I must say. and Mamie and I are going to be getting together in Vancouver and having lunch real soon, but it's a real joy to just see you in person. I know we've texted a bit, Mamie, but it's great to see your shining, beautiful face. And keep up the great work you're doing on your life.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Lots of love to you all. Thank you so much for just everything you do and for your love and support. It just means the absolute world to us.
Well, you're both just adorable to have joined us. And the fun is really just starting, Hearties. So We have a whole season ahead of us. We have show premiering April 7th. We have Johannah and Aaron's film coming on the 6th, and lots of chats that we're going to be having. So get ready. You're going to tweet with us, of course, for the movies and on the night of the premiere, always using the hashtag Hearties to fuel those ratings. And we hope that you'll subscribe to our YouTube channel so you don't miss a single chat. And we'll see you next time on Heart to Hearties.
Aww. Have a great afternoon, everyone. Evening. All the best. Lots of love. See you soon.